to be in the house of the Lord this morning.
Amen.
Amen. I don't know about you, but I'm excited to be here.
Amen.
Yes. Excited to gather together in His name and worship the Lord today. I'd like to open us up reading a few scriptures and our word of prayer.
Amen.
And we'd also like to say we're so thankful to everyone that prayed for Pastor and lended a hand in that and was able to come and visit and do everything, and we just appreciate that so much. In Psalm chapter 98, verse 4, it says, "Make a joyful noise unto the Lord, all the earth. Make a loud noise and rejoice and sing praise. Sing unto the Lord with the harp and the voice of the psalm, with the trumpets and sound of cornet. Make a joyful noise before the Lord, the King. Let the sea roar and the fullness thereof, the world and they that dwell therein. Let the floods clap their hands. Let the hills be joyful together before the Lord. For he cometh to judge the earth with righteousness, shall he judge the world and the people with equity." You know, I'm just so thankful for the Lord. He's just so good.
Amen.
And I don't know, there was a few of us that made it there yesterday, but you know, they were singing at the place in Waco and Homestead Heritage, and you know, there was so much skill and so much talent, and they were just great with the instruments. But I don't know about you, but you know, when they began to sing that song in Hebrew, those little children, I just felt the Holy Ghost all over me. And it was just something about that song. You know, all the other songs, they were good and they had skill and it was great, but when they hit the first note on those instruments, when they began to sing that song, I just felt like if we had all raised our hands, if we had all lifted our voice in one mind and one accord, the Holy Ghost would have fell in that place. And that can happen here today. And Jesus said, out of the mouths of children and infants, thou hast perfected praise. And you know, some of us are a little older than these, and some of us are a little grown up, but we're still His children.
Yes.
We can still worship Him today.
Amen.
The Holy Ghost will fall in this place today if we come together in one mind and one accord and worship Him. Lord, we thank You for this day. We thank You for the opportunity, Lord, to gather together in Your name with Your people, Lord, and feel Your wonderful presence in this place. Lord, we thank You for the Holy Ghost. We thank You for Your mercy. We thank You for Your blood that washes white as snow, God. And we ask for Your Spirit to move in this place today. We ask for Your Spirit to fill every void and heal every broken heart, Lord. Heal every sickness, God, and do what only You can do in this place today. We came here today because we believe in You, Lord. We came here today to worship You, God, because You are good and Your mercy endures forever. And we ask for Your blessing upon this service today. In Jesus' name.
I'm not afraid.
to the Lord in prayer this morning. We need to remember Sister Ruby Krennick and Mary Bivens and Gene Daniels. We need to keep lifting them up to the Lord. We need to remember Michael Jeffrey and Anthony Donoso, these that are incarcerated. They need the Lord to touch them. We need to remember Alicia and Bethany and Mary and Adam and Amanda. Amen. We need to remember the Demon family. Amen. Lord, work in
the name. Thank you,
my Lord. Jesus. Amen. Are there any other needs this morning?
Thank you.
Take them to the Lord, Brother Salinas.
Thank you, my brother, Lord. Really, my
brother. Amen. Let's pray for Ram. Let's also pray for Nick Hernandez. Amen. I want the Lord to touch them today.
Thank you, Lord.
Let's go to the Lord in prayer this morning. Your heavenly Father, God, I thank you, Lord Jesus. I know that you are a God that is not afar off. Lord, nothing is too big and too hard for you to handle, oh Lord. We come before you today, Jesus. We pray for Sister Ruby Krennick, God. We pray for Mary Bivens. God, for Gene Daniels. Lord, we pray for these elders. We ask, God, for you to move and minister in their lives. Touch Michael Jeffrey, Lord. Touch Anthony Donoso, Lord. We ask, God, for you to touch them and move upon. Touch Mary, Bethany, and Alicia, God. God, touch Adam and Amanda, Lord. We call these out to you today. Lord, we pray for Ram. We pray for Nick Hernandez, God. God, we pray for the Demon family, God. We ask, God, for you to move. And God, work in this life.
Thank you. Thank you. Keeping God.
Hallelujah. I'm thankful today that we serve that kind of God.
Yes.
That keeps his promises, keeps his word. Amen. If he says it, it will happen. Amen. If he says it, it will happen. Amen. Because he keeps his covenant. He keeps his word with us. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah. You can be seated this morning. Amen. We're going to ask our ushers to come. Amen. And as they're coming, I'd like to say I appreciate everybody this morning, all of our visitors, Miss Christine, and I believe it's Christine, and her daughter. We're so very thankful that they were in service with us today. Good to meet Chris and his, and I've met his family before, but I got to meet Chris today. We're so glad that you're here. Pray, Lord Jesus. God, we thank you for your spirit that is in this place, the mighty move of your spirit that is continuing to work, God. Lord, we ask God for you to bless this tithe and this offering that is given unto you. God, as we worship and giving in Jesus' name, amen. Give us unto the Lord today.
Praise God.
Amen. Amen. I believe that the Lord has done some things already in this service. Amen. If you have not received what you need from the Lord today, amen, the service is not over. And you need to respond to him.
Yes.
Praise God.
God responds to response.
That's
exactly
right.
There was a place in the scripture that says that he would have passed them by.
Uh-huh.
He would have walked right by them.
That's right.
Had they not have recognized his presence and cried out to him. He probably would have walked by blind Bartimaeus. And I'm sure that he walked by him many times in the 3.5 years of his ministry. But this last time, Bartimaeus. See, the common denominator was Jesus was walking by. But the difference this time was that blind Bartimaeus began to respond to Jesus coming by. And he begins to cry out and he receives healing when he responds to the presence.
Yes.
And the Lord is in this place today. And if you will respond to him, amen, he will minister to you and meet your need.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
In
Jesus' name.
Yes.
Amen. This is a wonderful month. We have a lot of activities with family and family-oriented activities this month, and we're so thankful for all the families that are in this church. And Sister Emily has a few announcements that she needs to make. Everybody say, Lord bless Sister Emily.
Lord bless Sister Emily.
Lord bless each and every one of you.
Amen.
Real quickly, our Sunday school department, I saw some of our kiddos running around. They are already beginning. They are doing a fundraiser for Christmas for Christ, which is for North American missions. And I've been announcing this for a while about North American missions. Words are hard this morning. So the kiddos are going to be selling some chocolate bars and some Airheads. So whichever kiddo raises, I keep calling them kiddos, whichever Sunday school young person raises the most by December 17th, they are going to get a special treat of being taken out for ice cream. So our young people are going to be doing that. So if they come around asking you about it, that's what it's for. And then also for our adults, the North American Missions envelopes are in our literature display. If you would like to give towards that, the envelopes are pre-marked with amounts on them. So just pick the envelope that you're wanting to give and just put it in the offering plate between now and December 24th. And then Saturday, December the 9th, our young people are going to Ballora for a Christmas light outing at 6 p.m. That will be enjoyable for them. And then Sunday, December 10th, is our ladies' Christmas gathering at Sister Danielle's apartment. It's going to be a lot of fun. So Make sure you come prepared to do a gift exchange. If you have any questions about it, I did already send out some details, but if you have questions, feel free to ask me. Saturday, December 16th is our hyphen Christmas party at 6 p.m. It will be at Chili's. Make sure you bring a gift for a gift exchange for that. Sunday, December 17th is our Christmas service, and our Sunday school department will be having a little Christmas party for them that morning in Sunday school. And then Sunday, December 24th, we are having a Christmas Eve service. It will be that morning. We will start at 11 a.m., so there will be no Sunday school that morning. But we do have a guest speaker that day. And then Friday, December 29th, is all night prayer.
Amen.
Praise the Lord.
Praise God. Amen. I would like to say that we do have just the best set of youth pastors.
Yeah.
Brother Brendan and Sister Danielle. They took nine of our kiddos to the youth banquet this past Friday. I know they had a blast, so I'm thankful for them. They have a burden for the young people.
Yes.
Amen. They make themselves available to the young people.
Right.
And, you know, it takes sacrifice. Like Brother Brendan, he had to get off work early so that he could drive the van and pick all the young people up. And I appreciate Brother Brendan and Sister Danielle for all that you do. Amen. For the kingdom of God.
Yes. Yes.
Amen.
Yes.
Praise God. Praise God. We serve a great and mighty God.
Amen.
Amen. Praise God. We're so honored to have my wife's mother and dad with us today. Amen. Brother and Sister Wilkins. Sorry, I had a... And I, it's bad when you're almost 40, you start forgetting some things. I just had a brain moment there. So good to have Brother and Sister Wilkins in service with us today. We love them very much. We got to spend all day yesterday with them. And it was Sister Wilkins' birthday yesterday. And so we just spent the whole day with them and just enjoyed it tremendously. And we're very thankful that you are with us today. We have asked Brother Wilkins to minister this morning. So Brother Wilkins, will you come? Sister Wilkins, if you would like to come and say something, you're welcome to. Whatever you want to do. Praise the Lord. Amen. But I appreciate Brother Wilkins. I asked him at the last minute, and I said, man, I hate to do this to you, but you got something? He said, brother, I'm a preacher. I got something. I said, okay. Then let's listen to my brother and allow him to minister to you.
Amen. Amen. I wonder if we could stand this morning. I concur with Brother John Ratliff. I do not believe the Lord is done here by any means or any stretch of the imagination. I feel like there's people in this house that came needing something from the Lord today. And I hope that by the time I get through sharing what I believe the Lord has given me to talk to you about this morning, that there will be an increase in faith. There will be an expectation that whatever you have need of, He's here to meet that.
Yes.
Amen. I believe the Lord has already touched Brother Jesse Ratliff, and I am so thankful for that. I am believing that. I am claiming that. I'm asking that you stand with him in that, because he is a covenant-keeping God. Amen? And he has said in his own word that it's in the mouth of two or three witnesses that everything be established. And so I want to ask you here this morning, has anybody ever been healed by God? All right, we got witnesses. And so I want to say that the Lord's word himself says that by his stripes we are. That's at least two witnesses. And so it's a settled covenant and contract. And he is a covenant keeping God. Amen. And so So I believe my brother has received his healing because he is a covenant-keeping God. Amen. I want to turn with me briefly to the Gospel of Mark, the 8th chapter. And I want to start at the 13th verse. And it says, "And he left them, and getting into the boat, departed to the other side. Now the disciples had forgotten to take bread, and they did not have more than one loaf with them in the boat. And he charged them, saying, Take heed, beware of the leaven of the Pharisees and the leaven of Herod. And they reasoned among themselves, saying, It's because we have no bread. But Jesus, being aware of it, said to them, Why do you reason because you have no bread? Do you not yet perceive nor understand? And is your heart still hardened? And in this verse, the Lord is comparing their lack of perception and understanding to a condition of the heart.
Right.
Moving on. Having ears, do you not see? And having ears, do you not hear? And last but not least, if you can't see it and you can't hear it, do you not remember?
Remember.
And so we're going to come back and talk about these. When I broke the 5 loaves for the 5,000, how many baskets did you take up? And they said to him, 12. And when I broke the 7 for the 4,000, how many large baskets of fragments did you take up? And they said, 7. And he said to them, How is it that you do not understand? I wonder if we could take this to the Lord and have ask him to bless his word, to bless our hearts, to open our hearts and minds to receive the seed of the word of the Lord this morning. Lord Jesus, anoint in this house the ears of the hearer and the understanding of these people, God. Oh God, bring to their remembrance the things that you would have them remember, Lord. In the name of Jesus, in the name of Jesus, in the name of Jesus. Well, I'm going to say, if you're going to preach with me, you may be seated.
Amen.
So I'm going to say, pray with me, pray for me, and talk back to me. So I spent the last 26 years preaching in the state penitentiary on a weekly basis. And so I have a wide variety of people that attend my services. And so I'm used to somebody, instead of saying amen, whistling. I'm used to somebody, instead of saying hallelujah, stomping their feet. And they express their appreciation and their with you in maybe a little different ways than people who are more accustomed to a church setting. But the heart is still there. So I want to start today. The setting of this story in this Bible, in Mark the 8th chapter, is immediately after the Lord has just fed the 5,000.
That's right.
And so in that story, the word says that he asked his disciples, hey, what do we have? Because he had compassion on the crowd that had been with him. He had been teaching. And he knew that they were a ways from resources, and certainly enough resources to feed a crowd of 5,000 men. And the word doesn't even count the women and children, but we know that given what we know about culture and family in that time, there could have easily been 15 to 20,000 miles to feed in that location. And so he asked them, he said, and the word says he was testing them. What do we have? And they says, like, well, we got, 5 loaves and 2 fishes, but what are they among so many? And Jesus said, bring it to me.
Yeah. Amen.
Bring it to me.
Yep.
And the word says he gave thanks.
Yeah. Amen.
And then he distributed it Listen, this ain't the main point of the message today. But there's the God of the universe in robed in flesh. And he's got what is clearly not enough. And he's in that moment thankful.
Yeah. Right.
Can I tell you, there's a lesson right there for somebody.
Amen.
It doesn't matter what your situation
That's
looks
right.
like to you.
That's right.
It's what God can do with it if you bring it to him.
That's right.
Because if you put it in his hands,
oh, yeah,
and he's
yeah.
thankful for it,
yeah.
and he blesses it, it turns into a multiplication
oh,
that
yes.
requires baskets to pick up
That's right.
the abundance
yeah.
that is left over.
That's right.
Yeah.
Thank you, Lord.
Yeah.
Thank you, Lord.
Oh, that we could be thankful.
Yes.
And in spite of all of that, when they go to get in the boat, what do? They bring one loaf with them. Now, that's either a tremendous amount of faith or a complete lack of plan. And I think we're going to find out it was a complete lack of plan. Because the scripture says that when he said to them, beware of the leaven of the Pharisees and beware of the leaven of Herod.
Yeah.
He was talking about kingdom.
Right.
And the title of my message today is when Jesus is talking about kingdom and you think he's talking about lunch.
Yeah.
We're going to start there today.
Yeah.
Because I can so identify with these apostles, these disciples
yes.
that followed him around, because time after time after time in scripture, he's speaking to them of heavenly things. He's speaking to them of eternal things.
Right.
And he's talking to them about stuff that's going to have thousands of years of effect.
Right. Right.
And they're like, he's mad because we only brought one loaf. And the focus and the shift and that was he was trying to get them, because they had just left the scene of a miracle.
That's right.
And they were worried about not having enough bread.
Yeah.
All right, I'm sneaking up on you. I'm telling you.
Yeah. Yeah.
Because here's what happened in this situation. What he was really talking about. He says in another place in the Gospels, the leaven of the Pharisees is hypocrisy.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You say one thing.
Yeah.
You project yourself as one thing and you live another.
Oh,
don't shout me down because I'm preaching.
I'm
here to tell you today that what leaven does is that it mixes itself so pervasively into a measure, a meal that's going to be made into bread. So that it doesn't matter, there's not a particle or a section or a piece or a lump
right.
of anything in that measure that's going to become a meal that isn't affected by the leaven.
Yeah.
And what Jesus was trying to convey to them is like, hey, I know what you see in front of you walking around like they so high and mighty are hypocrites.
Yeah.
Jesus.
Don't let that affect you. Be authentic. Be real.
Yeah. Yes.
Be genuine followers of Christ.
Yes. Yes.
Be my salt and light in this world.
Amen. Amen.
Yes.
And that was the message he was consistently preaching throughout his time on this earth. And then the leaven of Herod was a similar deal on a different scale, because the Jews had never been, I mean, they were a proud people. And when Rome came to conquer them, they had a scrap on their hands. It was so bad. It was so bad that at some point in time, there was
excuse me.
There was this uneasy tension between the Jews' desire to be autonomous and the heavy hand of Rome. And man, you read the history on Herod, and that man was brutal. Killed a couple of his own kids because he thought they was trying to take his throne. I mean, and so what Jesus was saying is, there's a way that Herod governs with extreme suspicion and fear.
Uh-huh. Amen.
That I don't want you to get mixed up in your spirit.
Right.
I don't want it to affect you in how you deal with your brothers and sisters.
Uh-huh.
He went on to say that if you're going to be first in the kingdom, you're going to have to be a servant to all.
Right.
Yeah. He went on and time again, even at the Last Supper, he washed feet when he only had hours left to live.
Yeah.
He was trying to eliminate the relevance and the effect of the leaven of Herod on their life.
Right.
Yeah. Right.
And so in this teaching, and he that's the Jews, the last thing they did, they literally just got done eating.
Yeah.
A meal from 5 loaves and 2 fishes. And you know what they did? Jesus was telling them, I'm the bread of life.
Yeah.
Right. I'm sent from God. Uh-huh. If you believe on me,
yeah,
if you'll follow me. And they were like, well, you need to show us a sign.
Yeah.
Run your tongue around your lips. And taste that food you just ate.
Yeah.
And ask me again for a sign.
Yeah.
Are you kidding me? Because that's what it was. It was so in their face and so obvious. And they was like, oh, no. See, when we were in the wilderness, we got fed manna.
Yeah.
And so you're going to have to come up with something like manna in order to impress us. And when Jesus got in the boat, he was like, these dudes are hypocrites. They're sitting in there eating a miracle meal and asking for a sign. So, but in order to bring the conversation where their answer had revealed that their mindset was, what he said to them was, okay, you heard what I said when I asked you, what do we have?
Yeah, that's right.
And you saw me give thanks.
Right.
In fact, the Gospel of John, when it relays this story in the 6th chapter, later on, I think there was about 11th verse where this miracle took place. And in verse 21, it marks that place on the Sea of Tiberias as the place where Jesus gave thanks.
Amen.
It wasn't the place where he fed the 5,000.
Uh-huh.
It wasn't referred to as that. It was the place where Jesus gave thanks.
Amen.
He gave thanks for not having enough. And I'm going to tell you, in your mind right now, I'm praying that the Holy Ghost will point to you some area of your life where you feel in your spirit that you do not have enough. And I'm here to tell you today, I want the Lord to open your understanding so that you can reach out by faith. And we've already seen a witness of hands of healing. So if you need healing for your body, it's in this house today. I'm here to tell you that if you need to be baptized with the Holy Ghost and fire, evidenced by speaking in tongues, I can prove to you it's in this house today.
Amen.
And it's all about what you can hear. It's all about what you can see.
Amen.
And if not both of those fail you, it's what can you remember?
Yeah.
Because in this house today are miracles.
Yes.
In this house today are miracles. And I believe we've already seen one in Brother Ratliff's body. And I believe that time will bear that out. And I'm here to tell somebody today, if you need the Holy Ghost, it's in this house today. It's in this house today. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Hallelujah, hallelujah. And so Jesus went back through it. He goes, all right, I was talking about kingdom, but somehow you misconstrued that as lunch. But even if I was talking about lunch, let's just say I wasn't talking about lunch, but let's just say I was. And he goes back and he reviews what just happened. How many loaves? How many fishes? How many baskets left over? And the other time when I fed 4,000, how many loaves? 7. How many baskets left over? 12. And then he looks at them and he goes, how is it that you don't understand? Even if I had been talking about lunch, one loaf in my hand is more than enough to feed everybody in this boat.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Amen. That's right.
Yeah.
Can I tell you that if that number of 5,000 people being fed is beyond the capture of your thoughts and imaginations, and it probably should be, because I'm pretty sure none of us in this room have ever seen anything like that. But do you think that if you could have seen that, would you have been able to believe that one loaf in his hands would have been enough for their immediate need? And that's what he was saying. Oh, yeah. I'm trying to show you that it's the Father's good pleasure to give you the kingdom.
Yeah.
Amen. Yes.
He goes, in another place, he said, which of you having a son that asks for bread?
Yeah.
Amen.
Are you going to give him a stone?
Yeah.
Uh-huh. No, you ain't doing that. And he asks for meat. Are you going to give him a scorpion?
Think about it.
No, you're not doing that.
Yep.
But if you, being natural, carnal men, know how to give good gifts to your kids, and here's today's question. How much more does your Heavenly Father desire to give the kingdom?
Yes.
Can I tell you that he's like, oh man, I see that brother over there, that sister over there. I see faith kind of starting to rise in their heart and mind. And I'm here to let you know today that whatever you have need of, he brought it with him. He's God, and he never shows up empty-handed.
That's right.
Are low in inventory.
Yeah.
That's right.
Yeah,
that's right. Thank you.
There's no such thing as a shortage in the kingdom. Whatever the inflation numbers are, don't matter to God.
That's right.
Whatever whatever the bottleneck is anywhere that causes there to be a lack of supply that we see in the natural economy of our country.
Yeah.
That don't affect him.
Oh,
that don't affect him.
Because
I can tell you, his arm is not short, and his ear is not deaf.
Right.
Neither.
Come on.
Because eye has not seen, and ear has not heard.
Yeah.
It hadn't even entered into the heart of a man the things that God has prepared for his people. Can I tell you, he came today to meet your need. And he came today to tell you that it doesn't matter if you have a loaf and it's not enough for lunch. He can multiply it. He can make the miraculous happen in your life. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
God has always responded in faith. God has always been impressed by people who had an understanding of who he was and what he could do.
That's right. Yes.
Yep, I believe it.
The story of the Syrophoenician woman.
Yeah.
who approached him and said, I have a child that's sick.
Right.
I need you to pray.
Uh-huh.
And this next thing that he said still blows my mind. He looked at her and he goes, yeah, but I can't really give the kids' food to dogs.
Yeah, that's what he said. He said that.
Yeah.
It was offensive.
Yeah.
In fact, it was a racial slur.
Yeah.
Yes.
Can I tell you that she recognized who he was enough?
Yeah.
To say, I'm not going to let something simple like a racial slur keep me out of my miracle because I know he's able. And if I can just get to him, if I can just get him to hear my case, if I can just get him to respond to my need, it don't matter what he says or what he calls me. Can I tell you that what you want from God sometimes is on the other side of something that probably looks like it's an offense to you?
Yeah.
That's good.
Yeah.
Can I tell you that if you can find a way to brush past the offense and keep your focus on the God of all eternity who holds the power of life and death in his hand and in his words, your miracle is waiting on the other side of your opportunity to be offended. I feel the Holy Ghost in this house today. I'm here to tell somebody, it doesn't matter what they call you. It doesn't matter how they look at you.
Right.
If you can touch the hem of his garment. The woman with the issue of blood suffered for 12 years. Spent everything she had. And grew worse. Obviously a woman of some means and resources. To keep going to doctors for 12 years and traveling, no doubt, after she had exhausted the resources of the locals.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
And working off of testimony.
Yeah.
Hey, I heard about this guy over here. He helped a friend of mine.
Yeah.
Oh, that's 100 miles. I don't care. I've got to be made whole.
Yeah.
And she would spend her money and she would go and she would get worse. But she kept believing that somewhere there was a cure, and then she heard about this man Jesus.
Yeah,
man. And there was testimonies of limbs being made straight and life being given back to legs that had been long useless. And she said, oh, if I can just touch him. Her miracle started with her confession that all she needed to do was touch him. There was no history of anybody touching him prior to that.
Right.
Do you understand that it was her faith in being in that kind of a proximity to him that brought her to a place where her confession of her miracle started before she ever laid eyes on him? How you talk about your situation matters. Can I tell you that if you came here today saying, oh, if I can just get in his presence, then you came to the right place. How can I tell you that if you said, I don't know if God still cares about me. I may have gone too far, done too much. If I will tell you, there's nothing that the blood won't cover. I'm here to tell you that the blood has never lost its power. And I believe that the reason she was talking about touching the hem of his garment was because there were a number of factors that were working against her.
Uh-huh.
Number one, she was ceremonially unclean.
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
As such, she was required to let everyone in earshot know.
Yeah.
Unclean.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
Unclean.
Yeah.
It was incumbent upon her that everywhere she went, she had to self-announce her inability to interact with society as a whole.
My.
And she had said in her heart that the only way I can touch him is if I get so low that can't nobody see me and recognize me for my past. Because she had a reputation after 12 years of walking around saying unclean that people knew who she was. Because the other part of that was, if you were touched by her, you had to go segregate yourself for 7 days.
Yeah. That's right.
You had to quarantine, if you will. And so she was like, I'm not telling anybody anymore. And I'm going to go low in case somebody might recognize who I am.
Amen.
And the word says that the crowd was thronging him that day. And that they were jostling and it was packed and it was tight. And I'm sure a couple of those rougher cut disciples was kind of like putting their shoulder into some folks trying to make a path for maybe a forearm. There was some rough cut boys in that bunch. And so here he is, he's trying to move through the crowd and he's getting pushed and shoved and everybody wants to see him and they want him to touch them. But she said, I don't care, I don't need that. If I can just get to him, if I can just touch the hem of his garment, I will be made whole. Oh, I want faith to rise in somebody's heart this morning. I want you to begin to confess over your life that if I can just touch him, I will be made whole. There's nothing in your life today that his blood can't handle. There's no situation too difficult. It doesn't have too many layers. It's not pulled and twisted in too many directions. It's not so complicated that the God who arranges galaxies on a daily basis can't say, well, I think I can move this over here and that. Because you know what the word says? All of his ways are perfect. Can I tell you I'm limited? And most of the times I feel like I'm going through life, you know, just kind of playing checkers. Like, okay, if I move here. And then I look back at what God's doing, it's like he's playing 3D chess or something. I mean, he's just way beyond my ability to comprehend.
That's right.
But when I look back over the course of my life, I see his fingerprints everywhere.
Yeah.
And man, has he done an amazing job.
Oh, yeah.
It's perfect.
Yeah.
It's perfect.
Jesus.
Yeah, that's what we're offering here today. That's what we're offering. If you will take the one loaf that's not enough. And you will bring it and put it in his hands. Can I tell you, he's going to bless it. He's going to give thanks for it. It's going to multiply. It's going to be more than enough. It's going to be more than enough. Whatever you have need of today, he's not a God of just, I'm going to fill it up to this millimeter line. He's a God of abundance. Paul said about it this way. Now to him who is able to do exceedingly and abundantly above all I can ask
or think.
Now, if you're like me, and I suspect most of you are, what do you have the guts to ask somebody for? Really ain't even close to what your mind can come up with.
That's
true.
So I think that's why Paul said it that way. He's certainly able to do more than we can ask him for. But he really don't even get started till we have exhausted the limits of our imagination. about what we even think is possible.
Yeah.
We sing that song. Our God is more than enough.
Yeah.
He can supply all your needs.
Yeah. Right.
He is my El Shaddai.
Yeah.
He always looks out for me.
Yeah.
Jehovah Jireh.
Yeah.
He is my God.
Yeah.
And as we stand this morning, I wonder if there's somebody. I want everybody in the house to come forward this morning. I don't want anybody to feel like they have to walk to this front alone. And if you need something from God this morning, I'm going to ask you to come with everybody else. Come on. The waters have been troubled in this house by worship. I can tell you that there's a hovering presence of God over this house. I can tell you that whatever you have need of is available in this house today. Can I tell you that my God is more than enough? Hallelujah, hallelujah. Yes. Hallelujah, hallelujah.
Thank you.
And as they start to sing, we're going to start to worship. And I can tell you that I can feel the presence of God in this house.
Thank you,
if you'll find a way to press your way through the crowd. If you can find a way to touch the hem of his garment. If you can find a way to leave your identity of your past and be an unclean behind and say, I know if I can just touch him, I will be made whole. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Holy Ghost, fall in this house this morning. God, would you let your faith rise in the heart of your people? God, would you let everybody who needs something from you? Press, reach, touch. Hallelujah. I pray with us this morning. I pray with us this
Oh, my God.
That is too difficult for God to figure out and for God to handle, because He's already got it figured out.
Yes, He does.
Amen. He is in control today. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. He loves you.
Yeah, He does.
He loves you very much. Let this good work that the Lord has begun in you, let it continue.
Yes.
Let Him continue.
Yes.
Draw you closer. Amen. Let Him continue to reveal Himself to you. Amen. He loves you today. We'd like to say it's so good to see Sister Denny, Cindy Hines in service with us today. Amen. It's always a pleasure. Amen. Good to see everybody here. Thank you, Brother Wilkins, for ministering this morning. Amen. Is what we needed. Amen. It was the right time, the right place, and the right word. Hey, and when all those line up, things happen. And I believe things happen this morning. And I'm expecting to hear miracles. I'm expecting to hear what God did in your life.
That's right.
Amen.
That's right.
And I'm believing with you. Amen. That the Lord is going to continue to work in your situation. In Jesus' name. Can we stand?
Thank you.
Amen. So good to have Christine and her daughter with us in service. Very thankful for you. Chris, thank you for being here today, sir. Amen. It's good to see everybody. Amen. Amen. Praise God. Pastor Ralph, would you care to dismiss us in a word of prayer?
Yes.
Lord Jesus. Lord, so personal,
Jesus.
Lord, of a visitation of the Spirit here.
Yes. Thank you.
Lord, thank you for letting us bask in your presence. Yes. Just to know that you're here and you're working in our lives.
That's right.
I give you thanks for it, Lord. Yes. I just pray you'll go with each one of us. And Lord, let us get closer to you and draw closer to you. And let us, Lord, have an understanding heart of the things, Lord, that you're trying to do in our lives.
That's right.
So we don't miss them.
That's right.
That we don't miss the things that you're doing to draw us closer to you.
Do it, Jesus.
Help us to be recipients of everything you furnished for us through the cross.
Yes.
Going to the Calvary, Lord.
Yes.
Lord, I just pray you keep your hand upon each one as we go our separate way.
Thank you.
Bring us again, Lord,
at
the appointed time in your presence. In Jesus' name.
Jesus'
name. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Keep Brother Johnny in your prayers. He's been kind of under the weather.
Yeah.
Amen. And so we're just going to keep praying for him. Sister Selena.
Yes, I wanted to ask the church about my dog.
Can I get him
to die?
He
can. He will. Absolutely.
Let's pray right now. Amen. Let's pray for Brother Johnny and Sister Selena.
In the name of Jesus.
Dear Lord Jesus, God, we know, God, you are in control. God, Lord, there's nothing that is too hard for you to do. God, we pray for Brother Johnny this morning. We ask God for you to heal his body. Let virtue flow, God, in his body this morning. In Jesus' name. Lord, we pray for Sister Salinas. In this situation on her job, God, I ask for you to intervene and work, God, on her behalf. Lord Jesus, God Almighty, let the Holy Ghost minister, God, to Sister Salinas this morning. Oh, God, and give her peace and direction. In the name of Jesus, and we thank you for it today, Lord. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Everybody say, in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. You are dismissed in the fear of the Lord. God.